One of my favorite films of all times is The Assassination of Jesse James by the Coward Robert Ford, a film shot by the master Roger Deakins. Now, no one can replicate Mr. Deakins, but for educational purposes, we can most certainly try. The key word here is try. Before we dive into my poor man's version of the Deaconizer lens, I want to give you a little bit of backstory on this little journey. Now, I'm sure you've heard of this little film right here, Joker, and this was shot by Lawrence Schur. Now, Lawrence Schur is also known for his work on movies like The Hangover and The Garden State, and one of the coolest things about Mr. Schur is that he's created this website called Shot Deck. ShotDeck.com is an amazing resource for all filmmakers. It is a collection of screen grabs from thousands of films. And I know this is starting to sound a little bit like a commercial, but I promise you it's not. This is not a paid advertisement. I just legit am a user of ShotDeck.com. I use it all the time for inspiration on future gigs, and I just think it's a great resource to utilize. Now, because of the current state of affairs that the entire world just happens to be in right now, Mr. Schur has been recreating some grabs that he's found on ShotDeck just by using the resources that he has available to him at his home. He's calling it hashtag shots in isolation, hashtag shot deck edition, and he started a little competition for everyone to join in on the shots in isolation recreation fun. He's got 4 Joker posters signed by himself and Mr. Joaquin Phoenix to hand out to the winners, so I thought I'd give it a go. Now, I chose The Assassination of Jesse James by the Coward Robert Ford because I think that is one of the most beautifully shot films. It is quite challenging, one, because it was filmed by Roger Deakins, but also I primarily chose that film also because I've been wanting to do a video for quite some time now on my DIY poor man's version of the Deaconizer lens. Now, the Deaconizer lens is something that Deakins himself created, and he started playing around at home by taking the front element off of some lenses and putting them on the front of other lenses. Then he went to a professional lensing house and had some professionally made. And what they kind of did for some of them, they were taking the front elements off of some really wide angle lenses and putting them on some other macro lenses. And thus, the Deaconizer lenses were born. And to my knowledge, you can actually still rent the set of Deaconizers to this day. So first of all, if you've never seen The Assassination of Jesse James, I think you're doing yourself a huge disservice, especially if you're a student of cinematography. Just to catch you up on some things, if you don't know what I'm talking about, here's some shots where you can see that what the Deaconizer lenses are doing to the edges of the frame. It really creates a really cool, dreamy-like vignette, and these really help to tell the story because The Assassination of Jesse James is a period piece that takes place in the 1800s, and as you can see, the Deaconizer lenses add kind of this old, antique-y camera effect to the lenses. So what I think is really cool about it is rather than relying on post to get this effect, they really just nail it in camera. And if you guys follow the channel, you know how huge of a fan I am of filtration and all of that. I love trying to nail the look in camera. So of course I am a huge fan of these Deaconizer lenses. However, I can't quite afford those things. So I have kind of came up with my own poor man's DIY version of it. Let me show you that now. This right here is just your normal run-of-the-mill wide-angle lens converter. If you're someone like me that grew up doing skateboard videography back in the high school days, you probably used these to screw onto the front of your camcorder to get that really cool fisheye look for skate videos, which is pretty much necessary. However, if you're gonna do this, you're gonna wanna make sure that your wide-angle converter has a built-in macro on the back end, because that's gonna help you really kind of get closer to that Jesse James look, right? And this is pretty simple. You just take it, flip it around backwards, you put the front side up against your lens, and then I smooshed it in place with my matte box, and it works out pretty well, and it's really that simple. Now, the shots that I chose for my recreation of The Assassination of Jesse James, none of these shots actually were ones that were shot with the Deaconizer lenses. The movie wasn't shot entirely with those lenses. They had a couple different sets of lenses on set, and they really only used the Deaconizer lenses for nice transitional moments. And I know what you're wondering. You're like, well, Justin, why didn't you just choose grabs from Shot Deck that actually were shot with the Deaconizer lens? Well, again, you know, we're still in shutdown here in California, so I just had to pick shots that I knew I could somewhat hopefully recreate with what I have available to me here at my home right here, right now. You know, I don't have access to all my normal cronies that I normally would, right? Or else I would have. And again, I also have just been itching and trying to figure out for quite a few months now how to incorporate my DIY Deaconizer lenses in a YouTube video, right? So I'm kind of killing two birds with one stone here. Now, to me, the coolest part about Shot Deck is for every shot on the website, you can click on it and it instantly reveals tons of awesome technical details about that shot. The location, the aspect ratio, the lighting type, the frame size, the composition, even the camera and lenses that was used on the film. It's a huge learning tool. And this all comes in handy for recreating our shots for the hashtag shots in isolation competition. So let's dive in right away. Shot one here, I'm just calling the farm stable shot. So what we can do, we can click on this picture and instantly we can find out two very important things. One, we find out that the aspect ratio of the assassination of Jesse James is 239. So that's very good to know for these recreations. And also we can see what kind of lighting it was, meaning this is daylight balance, this tells us. And also it's good to know that this is a side light top light. So this is all great stuff to know right off the bat for our recreations. But then what I like to do, I like to click the image and you can open up a high res version of it, and I like to kind of analyze the photos myself. I like to figure out where they put the key light on set. And one of the easiest way to do this is just to zoom in on the eyeballs. And right here, you can see that it is actually parked upstage frame right? So that is good to know right away. Now, another cool thing that I like to do with these images, I like to take the high res photo and drop it into DaVinci Resolve. And I have this Time in Pixels false color plugin that I drop on the node and we can instantly see what's going on with the contrast levels. Now, Mr. Deakins is literally the man when it comes to massaging light levels and color. So there's literally no way we can actually recreate these images, not in my opinion anyways, but you know, just the very fact that I'm using my poor man's Deakinizer lenses for all these shots that they didn't use the Deakinizer lens on, you know right away that we're not exactly going for 100% accuracy here. So let's look at the production value of this photo. I mean, right away they have this wonderful texture of all this straw. Now I live in LA and there's not a whole lot of straw readily available, especially during a shutdown. You know, we live in the concrete jungle here. But then Marianne reminded me that we had this old bamboo privacy fence that we tore down off of our back porch. And so we took some scissors to it and started chopping it up. So this isn't quite the same, but it still added a little bit of that texture and everything. And the vignetting that is caused by my DIY Deakinizer lens, it's actually helping sell that bamboo as straw a little bit more. For the lighting, I just kept it super simple. I just used my Aputure 120D. It's what I use for all my Talking Head YouTube stuff. I threw on the Mini Dome Mark II on there with the internal reflector with the diffusion and grid on the outside. And just to soften and bloom it up a little bit more, I threw some unbleached muslin over the dome. And I also parked a big sheet of Duvetyne right off camera left. And as far as the light levels go, I just did my best to match the false color on my monitor with the false color from the Time in Pixels false color plugin that was on the original shot. And what else is cool about the Time in Pixels plugin is that you can actually set it to whatever false color you're used to seeing. So with me, they have the Blackmagic Video Assist as an option. Honestly, I think the hardest part of this shot was the framing. So Marianne is laying on the ground and she's looking straight up at the camera. So I just flipped the monitor around so she could try to frame herself up going by that, because the tripod is jacked up as high as it'll go directly above us and pointed down looking at us. And then I printed out on a big 8x10 piece of paper the original shot, and I gaff taped it to the tripod so she could look at the monitor and then down at the photo and try to line up where the girl was laying. And then with me, since I'm looking the other way with my back to camera, because it's essentially a straight up over the shoulder shot of the villain there, and I'm playing the villain, I took the iPad, threw it on the ground, and was sending the signal via the Axun Cine Eye to the iPad. And we kind of did our best trying to line that up, but that was probably to me the most difficult part of this shot. Now, I shot this on the Pocket 4K in Blackmagic RAW, which made it a lot easier trying to match with the original photo. And also what I like to do is I put it on the timeline in Resolve, and then I imported the original photo and put that on the timeline right next to it, so I could keep jumping back and forth and comparing the RGB parade and the vector scope and making sure everything was lining up, trying to get it as close as I could. Okay, shot two is from the infamous train track scene, and this shot was probably the easiest of the three. So I learned from Shot Deck that this was primarily an underlight, which you can tell if you further analyze it, and you know, it looks probably like it was candlelight, but also from what I know from the BTS of this movie, I could probably guess that it's actually a gas lamp. I don't have access to either of those things, so again, I just used my 120D with the dome, still with the diffusion and grid, but this time I threw a soft amber gel in there to help warm it up, give it more of that tungsteny feel, and then to help it even more, I doubled up on the unbleached muslin and draped it over the dome. I put that light really, really low as it could go, dimmed it way, way down, and then just made a little uplight out of it. Then I took my Duvetyne from the first setup and just now use it as my big backdrop. And here was a case where my DIY Deakinizer lens really helped sell that it was nighttime, because it has so much natural vignetting on its own. Okay, now for shot three, definitely the weakest of the three and not anywhere nearly as close. It was definitely a fail on my part. It's what Marianne calls a swing and a miss. Now, despite my best efforts, I could not for the life of me get a large enough reflection on the wall. As you can see here, they have these awesome water reflections on the wall. The reality is I just did not have a large enough container to put water in, nor the right size mirror to pull this off. And as best as I tried, Marianne just wouldn't allow me to bring a kiddie pool full of water into the living room. So I had to kind of go a different route. I did for a while, a very long while, try messing around with a silver bowl full of water and put different things in it like broken CDs and balls of tinfoil. But at the end of the day, it just wasn't a large enough pool of water to get what I was after. So I just said, okay, I'm over this. And I ended up just taking that 120D, I took the mini dome off, threw on the 2X Fresnel, and then took one of my homemade Kookalorises and put it in front of that 2X Fresnel to just kind of get some interesting kind of shapes of light to take the place of the water reflections. But something interesting to take note of here, here is my crazy image. Now, like I said, it is not nearly as identical. It's more of like an ugly step cousin, but I really like what the DIY Deaconizer is doing with the light there. It kind of looks really wild. It almost looks like something out of Minority Report or something. So I still thought it was cool, so I still wanted to include it. So there you have it, folks. Let me know in the comments down below what you think about my DIY poor man's version of the Deaconizer lens. And if you need some inspiration, you should check out shotdeck.com. Also, if it's before May 18th, you still have time to join the competition. So go on over there to Instagram, follow ShotDeck, follow Lawrence Scher, and be sure to leave the hashtag #ShotDeckEdition and #ShotsInIsolation.
Hey, if you're a fan of the channel and like to support, there's a couple different ways you can do that. The first and easiest way is to just hit that subscribe button and be sure to hit the bell so you get the latest videos as soon as they're dropped. But if you want to go above and beyond that and be a part of a daily filmmaking conversation, then I invite you to join the Dog Times community over on Patreon. That is where once a week I release an exclusive members-only video breaking down projects, talking gear, and sharing real-world experiences as a DIY indie filmmaker in Los Angeles. But my favorite part about the Patreon is the conversations happening over on Discord. That is where you will be connected with like-minded filmmakers and have instant access to learning ways to improve your own skills so you feel more confident about working on set as a professional. So welcome to the Dog Times community, and I'll chat with you soon.